Harper Audio presents Queen of Scots, written and read by John Guy. Mary Stuart was born in the coldest of winters. Snow blanketed the ground, and the narrow pathways and rough winding tracks between England and Scotland were completely blocked. The cattle that roamed the lowlands and the valleys of the border region during the summer months were crouching in their low stone byres. The River Tweed, often a raging torrent as it flowed to the sea at Berwick-upon-Tweed on the eastern side of the border, was frozen over. Whereas it normally took a rider 5 or 6 days to carry important dispatches from Edinburgh to London, the news of Mary's birth took 4 days to reach Alnwick in Northumberland, only a few miles south of Berwick. The new baby was the only daughter and sole surviving heir of James V of Scotland and his second queen, Mary of Guise. She was born at Linlithgow Palace, some 17 miles west of Edinburgh, on Friday, December the 8th, 1542. The deep frost scarcely troubled the occupants of the Queen's suite on the third floor of the northwest tower of the palace. James V had lavish tastes and sought to introduce the latest Renaissance styles. The windows of the palace were glazed, the ceilings painted, the stonework and woodwork intricately carved with crowns and thistles. In the great hall and throughout the dozen or so rooms of the royal apartments, logs blazed in the fireplaces. Linlithgow, along with Falkland in Fife, was a favourite lodging of Mary of Guise. She had helped to redesign both palaces like French chateau. This was hardly surprising because she was herself French. She was the widowed Duchess of Longueville, the eldest daughter of Claude, Duke of Guise, and his wife Antoinette of Bourbon. The Guise were one of the most powerful noble families in France. Mary Stuart was born at a turning point in history. Only 2 weeks before, on November the 24th, her father's forces had been routed by the English at the Battle of Solway Moss. To the Scots, England was the old enemy. Relations between the two neighbours had smouldered since Edward I had claimed the feudal overlordship of Scotland and tried to annex the country in the 1290s. The Scots sought French and papal support and fostered a hardy patriotism in defence of their kingdom's independence. Border skirmishes were the norm. Outright war was the exception, not least because the two countries were so unequally matched. England was so much richer and more powerful than its northern neighbour. The only Scottish town of any size was Edinburgh, where 13,000 people lived. This was at most a fifth of London's population. It was far easier to raise taxes and levy troops in England than in Scotland, since the machinery of government was more centralised and the chain of command more efficient. A set-piece battle would almost inevitably end in a crushing defeat for the Scots. The wars within the British Isles had resumed under Henry VIII, who came to the English throne in 1509. Henry was a strong leader. He saw himself as an English patriot and also as a military strategist. His ambition was to resume the Hundred Years' War against France and to win conquest there. If Henry sought to conquer French territory, he had to deal first with Scotland, France's old ally and England's back door. A popular rhyme quipped, "Who that intendeth France to win, with Scotland let him begin." Henry was fond of quoting it, and he put its lessons into practice. Typically, the defeat of the Scots at Solway Moss was less the result of a full-scale English invasion than of a border skirmish that went tragically wrong. The disaster stemmed less from Henry VIII's aggression than from James V's decision to launch a counterattack on an epic scale without choosing the ground or the moment carefully enough. In reaction to the incursions of English forces led by the Duke of Norfolk, James sent an army to pillage the disputed territory to the north and east of Carlisle, known as the Debatable Land. His troops forded the River Esk at low tide. When they returned, it was high tide and they were caught between the river and a bog. Forced to retreat by a smaller but better disciplined English battalion, the Scots were snared. Around 1,200 were taken prisoner, including 23 important nobles and lairds, who were dispatched as hostages to London, where they were put in the Tower. James V felt a deep psychological blow. he had been militarily and personally humiliated. His loss of face the greater in that he had been ensconced safely at a distance and was not leading his troops. Cowardice was not the issue. James was a brave warrior, but he misjudged the risks. The result was a disintegration of his forces. It was a more damaging loss to his reputation than that suffered 30 years before by his father, James IV, whose own army had been cut to pieces at Flodden Field by the father of this very same English commander. The political effects of both defeats, along royal minority, were identical. James V rode to Linlithgow to see his wife begin her confinement, but almost instantly left for Edinburgh and then Falkland, where he took to his bed. It is unlikely that he loved his wife, since he took so many mistresses. But he cared greatly about his baby, and his sudden departure tells us more about his mental state than about his family ties. He went to pieces when told that his heir was not a boy. His two infant sons had died the previous year, and now his thoughts turn to Marjorie Bruce, King Robert I's daughter and the founder of the Stuart dynasty. He exclaimed, "The devil go with it. It will end as it began. It came from a woman, and it will end in a woman." James died at midnight on December the 14th. He was only 30, but had suffered recurrent illnesses. A life of sexual dissipation, leading to pox and endemic fevers, and a serious hunting accident had weakened his immune system. He died of natural causes, unlike his father, who had perished at Flodden in the murkiest of circumstances. Although seemingly killed by the English in the battle, it is just as likely that he was murdered in the closing stages of the fight by one of his rebellious lords. His son had succeeded him at the age of 17 months. Now history had repeated itself. His granddaughter, Mary Stuart, was queen at the age of 6 days. Henry VIII was determined to outwit and outmaneuver France. According to his version of law and history, Scotland, despite being an independent state and a sovereign realm, would become a satellite of England, a jewel within the orb of Henry's imperial crown. It was the beginning of the Tudor claim to an Anglo-British empire that, while Mary was still a child, was to provoke a French counterclaim to a Franco-British one. A marriage between the infant Mary and Henry's own young son would smooth the way. As long as Henry VIII tried to subordinate Scotland to England and detach the country permanently from French influence, Mary of Guise meant to oppose him and to protect French and Guise interests there. She decided to move Mary from Linlithgow, a pleasure palace that could not withstand a siege, to the security of her own castle of Stirling, an almost impregnable fortress at the top of a steep rock. The child and her mother made their journey on July the 27th, 1543. Although barely out of swaddling clothes, the young Mary travelled with all the pomp and circumstance she would one day take as her due. Stirling Castle would be home to Mary and her mother for the next 4 years. It was an appropriate setting, as its magnificent great hall and royal apartments had been lavishly reconstructed as part of a massive royal rebuilding programme. The Great Hall alone could seat 300 people for dinner. On September the 9th, 6 weeks after their arrival, and by a delicious irony the 30th anniversary of the Battle of Flodden, Mary was carried in procession from her nursery at Stirling and crowned Queen of Scots in the adjacent Chapel Royal. It was an event of supreme significance. The coronation was the most solemn ritual known to church and state. Its symbolism was sacramental and conferred religious as well as civil legitimacy on her. In the course of the ceremony, a 9-month-old child was transformed into an anointed queen, possessed of those sacred powers of majesty that God alone could bestow or call to account. The crown, originally worn by James V at the coronation of Mary of Guise, was held over Mary's head by Cardinal Beaton, the Archbishop of St Andrews, who was dressed in scarlet. He blessed her and anointed her with holy oil. She howled volubly and kept it up while every bishop and peer present knelt in turn to recite his oath of allegiance. Henry VIII died in January 1547, followed 2 months later by Francis I, King of France. These titans had dominated the affairs of the British Isles and Northern Europe for 30 years. Suddenly, there was a vacuum. Henry VIII's son and heir, Edward VI, was only 9. A regent or protector would be needed to govern until the king was 18. But Henry had shied away from giving so much power to any one person. Instead, he had used his will to appoint a council of regency to rule during his son's minority. Despite this, Edward Seymour, Earl of Hertford, made himself Duke of Somerset and protector of the realm within a week. He took vice-regal powers to govern England and its dominions. His overriding aim was to realise Henry VIII's dynastic plan by uniting the two crowns of England and Scotland through Mary's marriage to Edward. In France, the Dauphin Henry succeeded his father. He was crowned King Henry II. The Guises were among his chief advisers. The result was that the new French king at once declared himself to be the protector of Scotland. He decided to spare no expense to safeguard the old alliance and to ensure that Mary would marry no one except his own son, the Dauphin Francis. He flatly countered Somerset's idea of an Anglo-British union with his own master plan for a Franco-British empire. In August 1547, Somerset invaded Scotland with a massive army. He intended to conquer the country and settle permanent English garrisons from coast to coast. He meant to occupy and subdue Scotland and so force it into submission. His army was shadowed by an English fleet as it made its way north, ready to open fire if his troops were ambushed by the Scots. For once, the Scots were ready. When, on September the 10th, the English infantry surmounted a hill close to Inveresk, near Musselburgh, on the eastern approaches to Edinburgh, they were confronted by the largest Scottish army in history. Some 12,000 troops were skillfully positioned behind defensive trenches on the west bank of the Esk. They were put there to block the road into Edinburgh, and since on one side of them lay the sea and on the other an impenetrable marsh, Somerset would have to either launch a frontal attack or wheel his army around. As Somerset turned in search of a defensive position, the Scots attacked. The armies clashed on the hills above the hamlet of Pinkie. For an awesome moment, it looked as if the Scots pikemen could win. Then the English ordered a shock cavalry charge and fired their heavy guns to deadly effect. The Scots buckled. In the bombardment and ensuing carnage, 10,000 Scots were scythed down and killed. It was a second Flodden. The way lay open to Edinburgh and Stirling. Mary, aged 4, was hastily carried in a litter by night to Inchmahome Priory, a remote spot on an island in the Lake of Menteith, some 85 miles from the battle. Somerset did not occupy Edinburgh. Instead, he started to build a grid of quick, cheap forts from coast to coast in an attempt to hold the entire country at his will. If he expected this to work, he miscalculated. The backlash was so huge, it led to the one thing he had inexplicably overlooked: the removal of the young Queen of Scots to France. Mary landed not far from Roscoff in Brittany in mid-August 1548. She was to spend her next 13 years in France. They were to be some of the happiest days of her life, and she did not travel alone. She was accompanied by her maids of honour and 4 best friends, Mary Fleming, Mary Beaton, Mary Seton and Mary Livingstone, the so-called 4 Marys. All almost exactly her own age and the daughters of leading Scottish families, they had first appeared as Mary's companions when she was taken by her mother to the island priory of Inchmahome. Mary Fleming, a cousin, enjoyed preeminence. She was famous for her quick wits and love of life. Mary Beaton's beauty was second only to Mary's, with whom she later shared a love of literature and poetry. Mary Seton, who stayed at Mary's side for almost her entire life, was famous as a hairdresser, able to braid and crimp the always fashion-conscious Mary's auburn hair into a new style every day. Finally, Mary Livingstone loved the outdoor life and dancing. Mary was 5 and a half when she arrived in France. Henry II welcomed her to the royal court at Saint-Germain near Paris and treated her as if she was his own daughter. He educated her alongside his own children. because he planned to marry.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.